The Good Shepherd calls his sheep by name. Listen, for our Shepherd is calling. Good morning to you, wherever you may be, and welcome to Mountain View United Church's online worship service for the fourth Sunday in Easter. I would like to start by saying that we extend our sincere condolences to those injured and the family, friends, and colleagues of those who were killed in the senseless violence that happened in Nova Scotia. We pray that God will offer them comfort and strength and courage. Please join me now in our call to worship. Christ, our Shepherd, calls us here from our isolation. God's gate of love has swung wide. Jesus, our brother, welcomes us home even in the midst of pain. The family of God embraces us all. Our mothering God invites us with love, for we are all precious sheep in God's pasture. Let us come together now in our opening prayer. Let us pray. God of love and grace, as you swing wide the gate of welcome this day, strengthen us to walk through the gate of your love and mercy. Protect us from harm as we lie down in the fields of your mercy and rise again to travel this journey of faith Speak to us through your teachings this day, that we may devote ourselves to your guidance and feed on your life-giving word. In the beloved name of Jesus, our shepherd, we pray. Amen.
God's story, generosity. So part of God's story is about how he wants us to be generous, and it goes like this. Being generous means sharing what you have. It's something God has always asked his followers to do. Remember how God built a special family called the Israelites? They were his very first followers. He taught them what to do by giving them laws, like giving 10% of everything they had back to God. That's called tithing. God even said to test him. If they obeyed and were generous with what he gave them, he would give them exactly what they needed. See, God is generous, and he wants us to be like him. He sent his greatest treasure, his son Jesus, to earth. Jesus left the kingdom of heaven and gave up his life to rescue us so that one day we can be a part of God's kingdom and live in it with him forever. Basically, Jesus gave up everything for us. Anyway, when Jesus was here, he showed us even more about being generous. In fact, Jesus said we can not only give a tithe, but we can give way more than that. We can give thirsty people water and hungry people food. We can visit people who are lonely and pray for people who are hurting. He did that all the time. He said when we do that, it's like we're giving to him. Jesus actually told us when we're generous, we show him we love him. He said, your heart will always be where your treasure is. That's a fancy way of saying you spend your money on what you care about. In the Bible, one day, a rich guy came up to Jesus and asked what he could do to live forever in God's kingdom. Jesus said, go and sell everything you have. Give the money to those who are poor. You will have treasure in heaven. Then, come and follow me. Jesus wants us to follow him with our whole hearts and care about him more than anything. Unfortunately, the man went away sad because he couldn't put his treasure in heaven. He loved the stuff he had on earth too much. Another time, Jesus watched people give offerings at the temple. One woman only put in a few small coins, but Jesus told his disciples, that poor widow has put more into the offering box than all the others. They all gave a lot because they are rich, but she gave even though she is poor. She put in everything she had. That was all she had to live on. The widow gave everything to Jesus, just like Jesus gave everything to us. Like the rich guy and the poor widow, all of us have different ways we can give. The Bible actually says we should give what we want. After all, God loves a cheerful giver. When we share joyfully with others, we're showing love to God. Our generosity shows Jesus how much we love him, just like his generosity shows how much he loves us. And that's the story of generosity. So in case you missed it, here's the quick version. God asks us to be generous. He wants us to be like him. God sent Jesus to us. Jesus gave up his life. Jesus showed us how to give. We give to things we care about. The rich guy cared about his stuff. The poor woman cared about Jesus. Jesus cares about us. We can love Jesus back by being generous. And that's a part of God's story.
Is greater than our faith.
Let us come before God in a spirit of confession. Let us pray. Even as the wounds of Jesus remind us of the healing and the hope Christ offers us this Easter season, we face our own wounds and fall into doubt and despair. Help us face the realities that separate us from you and from one another, O God. Guide our feet onto paths of health and wholeness, that we may walk closely with you and with those who love and care for us. Even those who have gone astray like lost sheep are welcomed back into the loving arms of Christ our Shepherd, the guardian of our souls. Rejoice, for all are welcome into God's grace through the gate of the Shepherd's love. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our New Testament reading is taken from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, beginning at verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Our gospel reading is taken from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 10, beginning at verse 1. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him, because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him, because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. There's a little town in Pennsylvania called Everett. Main Street is 2 miles long. As you leave town going east, you climb a little hill, then merge with the highway where steep cliffs rise up to the right, and there's a flock of wild goats that feed on the steep hills. Adult goats and little kids hop easily from stone to stone. These are graceful animals that seem to have little trouble surviving in what would be a hostile environment for most people. According to local legend, a farmer bought them to keep down the weeds, but they refused to cooperate. They ate what they wanted, not what he wanted. He is said to have driven them away when he grew tired of paying for feed, but the flocks survived. The problem is not the goats, but the drivers who spot them and crane their necks to see how they're doing. It's caused some traffic problems. Folks know they're out there. They might be missing for a month or a season, but eventually they return. And when they come back, people want to see them. Then people start talking about them. Folks at the diner will not only talk about seeing goats, but which ones. They have nicknames for them. They have nicknames for the goats, depending on their appearance, and they are happy to see old friends return on those hillsides. A few years ago, a couple of goats, well known around town, experienced some difficulty. One of them broke a leg and disappeared, then the other one disappeared. Letters to the editor of the local newspaper demanded an investigation. Prosecutions were demanded. And finally, letters from animal organizations appeared in the newspaper to assure folks that the goats were being cared for and that once healthy, they would be returned to the wild. The small town shares the same difficulties that folks have across the country in small towns. Lack of jobs, drug use, and education. So some might wonder why it is that the town would worry about a couple of goats. But folks know these goats. The goats are individuals to them, and that's the perspective of the shepherd toward the flock, whether it's a flock of goats, or in the case of this week's scripture readings, a flock of sheep. The good shepherd knows every member of the flock. They are all individuals. And they are missed when they are gone. And that's how we look to God. There are no disposable members of the human family. If we are lost members of the flock, Jesus will look for us. God knows us all by name. We are personalities to the Creator. And that's a comforting thought. The image of the shepherd as a symbol of leadership has strong roots in the Bible. God is depicted as the shepherd of Israel in a number of Old Testament passages, the most memorable of which is the 23rd Psalm. The Psalm contains the same sense of intimacy and protection found in John 10. The traditional imagery inspires John's portrayal of Jesus as the Good Shepherd, who, in contrast to leaders who are thieves and bandits, brings the people protection, guidance, and abundant life. This discourse of Jesus follows directly after the story in chapter 9 of the Sabbath healing of the man blind from birth. The man was subsequently expelled from the synagogue by the Pharisees. Then Jesus accused the Pharisees of spiritual blindness, and chapter 10 is his response to their challenge to him. Our reading consists of two sections, both of which are addressed to the Pharisees. The first, verses 1-6, contrast the true shepherd with the thieves and bandits who harm the sheep. The true shepherd enters the sheepfold by the gate, whereas the thieves and bandits, the false shepherds, climb in another way. An enclosure for the sheep would be constructed of a stone wall adjacent to the house. The wall might be topped by branches of thorns to discourage climbing. There would be one gate, usually able to be locked shut to prevent anyone from stealing the sheep. Thievery was common and caused great loss, since sheep were a source of food, meat and milk, and clothing, and a major source of barter for other goods. In our situation here, the flock was large enough to justify hiring a gatekeeper. We are told that the gatekeeper recognizes the true shepherd and lets him in. The sheep also recognize their shepherd by knowing his voice. This reflects actual circumstances. In traditional societies, the shepherd often knows each sheep by name, and they in turn recognize his distinctive call. In the Middle East, you can still see shepherds walking out in front of their herd, repeatedly calling to them to keep together. In John's scene, the true shepherd leads his flock out of the sheepfold to pasture. The Pharisees don't understand what Jesus is saying, but for those of us open to Jesus' word, the meaning is clear. Donald Sr. writes, "Jesus is a true shepherd, not only in the spirit of David, but reflective of God's own providential love. Jesus' relationship with his disciples is one of intimacy and trust. They listen to his voice and recognize him. He brings them no harm, but protects them. They willingly follow him, and he brings them to the source of life." Our second section moves in a different direction, because Jesus here identifies himself as the gate for the sheep. It's one of the many "I am" sayings in the Gospel of John. These revelatory declarations fuse the divine name revealed to Moses, "I am," with particular qualities expressing human longing for necessities. "I am the bread of life. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the light of the world. I am the way. I am the truth." The image of the gate by which the sheep can go to find pasture is used to express Jesus' role of bringing God's saving love to the world. While the thief comes to kill and steal and destroy, Jesus comes that they may have life and have it abundantly. The concept of life is fundamental to John's gospel. Life, in his terms, is to be understood not only as the vital force that animates a human being, but as eternal life, a share in the very being of God through faith in Jesus. It may be somewhat confusing hearing the two different roles of Jesus in one passage, both the shepherd and the gate. But the key to this entire passage lies in the final verse, "I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly." This is the vision Jesus has for all. Throughout this gospel, Jesus claims to provide the critical elements of abundant life: water, bread, light, and here shelter in the form of a sheepfold. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, leads us into oneness with God. Jesus also calls each one of us to grow in responsibility, to care for others, and to become good shepherds, servant leaders. This is a sign of spiritual maturity. Shepherding is all about caring for those who are weak, lost, and in need. It is about presence, love, and support. Shepherds are needed as much today as in Jesus' time to love people and guide them to greater life. We look to Jesus, the model shepherd, to guide us into our roles as shepherds. Just as Jesus looked to God for guidance, we look to our shepherd. The Gospels are full of ways that teach us how to love people. There is no doubt that we are all called to love and care for others and to support them in times of difficulty. The church in Acts 2 shared all things in common as a way of supporting each other. There are a lot of false shepherds out there making false promises they can't keep. The false promise of acceptance if you become thin enough or beautiful enough. To this, the true shepherd says, "Follow me and I will give you unconditional acceptance." The false promise of escape in the face of hardship that drives many to drugs and alcohol. To this, the church offers community that shares joys and suffering. The false promise that contentment comes by having more stuff. To this, the psalmist reminds us that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Jesus says to each of us, "I came that you may have life and have it abundantly." Let us accept this true promise and claim that abundant life from our good, true shepherd. Thanks be to God. Amen. We do not pray that we may change God. We pray that God may change us. Let us come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Holy Mystery, who is holy love, you, our shepherd, speak to us words of challenge and comfort in the companionship and support of others and in the gentle movements of the Holy Spirit. All of us have heard a call to take a moment from news broadcasts to come together in prayer. Help us to ponder your message amidst the overwhelming words around us. Help us to see moments of resurrection and new life amidst devastation and death. Help us to discern your path of compassionate love and care amidst hatred and fear. Help us to understand, holy love, how we can begin to imagine peace on earth when we are dealing with a deadly pandemic and an act of hatred and violence that shakes us to our core, seemingly in our own backyard. Holy love, how do we help those among us who are mourning the death and injuries of loved ones due to manufactured violence? Feel your comfort when grief, sadness, and loss seem to overshadow all other emotions. With the help and support of our family and friends, and by your grace, Holy Love, we take comfort in your words and trust in the promise that you, our Shepherd, will lead us beside still waters and restore our souls. With this assurance, we pray for all those affected by the mass shooting in Colchester County, Nova Scotia. Those who mourn the death of loved ones, and those in our global and local communities who are suffering and who mourn. And we give thanks for the first responders and support workers who continually and faithfully care for all affected by violence. With the assurance of the prayer that you taught us, we hold tight to your promise that the city of God will come to earth as it is in heaven, knowing that we are needed to make this a reality. And so we ask that you prepare us physically, emotionally, and mentally for this new reality. Prepare us to be the children of God in the world. Prepare us to be peacemakers. Prepare us to be compassionate voices in an often harsh world. Help us to be good stewards of our unique and individual gifts by responding to the needs around us with your vision, so that one day the poor in spirit may know the kingdom of God. Those who mourn may be comforted. The meek may inherit what is theirs. No one will hunger or thirst, and we will no longer have such days of violence and fear. We offer these prayers in the strong name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
With a shepherd's heart, go now to love the world around us, remembering that Christ's love will meet our every need. May God keep us and lead us all our days. Amen.
Faith in Action, submitted by Reverend Danny Compton. The line that stands out for me in today's gospel reading of the parable of the Good Shepherd is where Jesus says, "The sheep recognize the voice of the Good Shepherd," which can also be translated "true shepherd," "for he calls his own by name and leads them out, for they belong to him." I don't think we sometimes realize just how personally and intimately that God is concerned with our lives. When I see a flock of sheep, I see exactly that, a flock, a rabble of wool, a herd of hoofs. I see sheep, all alike, none different. That's what I see. That's not so with the true shepherd. For a true shepherd, every sheep is different. Every face is special. Everyone has a story. And every sheep has a name. The sheep trust the true shepherd and listen for his voice, and they trust the voice of the shepherd. Living through this uncharted pandemic has been at times frustrating and unnerving. So many voices with so many different directions. One suggestion could be, take a bit of time each day to listen for the voice of the shepherd. It has a different sound and can be recognized. I have permission to share the story of this voice speaking to two frontline nurses. One nurse spoke of fear of bringing the COVID-19 home to her family. In her text, she wrote to me, "I'm up early praying and thinking. We had our first death at my hospital from COVID-19. Somehow, though people are dying, it makes it more real when it's in my own community. At work, it is busy and stressful. Lots of coronavirus and employees and families are being exposed. God spoke to me through the words of Psalm 56. In God, whose word I trust, in God I trust, and will not be afraid. So I focus on being a hope and a light in the middle of it all." A second nurse, who was a staff manager at a nursing home, sent this text. "I had a crash day yesterday. The stress of it all caught up to me. I woke up feeling inadequate, and then, in the words of my daily devotional, I read it, and it said, 'As you go through this day, trust me to provide the strength you need moment by moment. Don't waste your energy wondering whether you are adequate for the journey. My spirit within you is more than sufficient to handle whatever the day may bring.' Perfect timing." Let us put our faith to action as we pray the words of Psalm 56:3. "But in the day that I'm afraid, I lay all my fears before you and trust in you with all of my heart." Amen. Go now in God's peace.